At this moment, I'm here with Dr. H. Chipongchum Sangtum, MT Pathology, Medical Officer in charge of Regional Diagnostic Center. I am TH Mohukchung. So today we are going to discuss with him regarding the TrueNet testing laboratory that we have here in Mohukchung. So before we start with our discussion, first of all, a very thank you to have availed your time to be here with our listeners and share about all the issues that is related to the TrueNet test, which is, of course, related to our very present pandemic of COVID-19. So first of all, what is a TrueNet test machine?
Thank you for having me on your program. TrueNet machine is a micro RT-PCR machine. It is similar to the RT-PCR machine used in other labs. I think most of you will be aware in Kohima also we have established one BSL lab. So in there they have that big RT-PCR machine. So it is a smaller version of that RT-PCR machine, and it is used for detecting the viral RNA. It is not like other tests where you do antigen or antibody. Just to give a small example, whenever like somebody is having fever, we go to the hospital and ask for some blood tests to be done. So that time most people might be aware there are some cards or something where blood is taken and tested. So those tests are done to detect antigen or antibody against that particular disease. But this TrueNet machine, it's not for detection of antigen or antibody, it detects the RNA of the virus. So it won't like give false negative or false positive report. It is like if the viral RNA is there, it will give the report. If it is not there, it will be negative.
We also have heard about the BSL-3 lab that is being set up in Kohima. So how is the TrueNet test machine different from this BSL-3 or 2 or 4 machines?
Let me just clarify on the meaning of BSL. Because BSL is like biosafety lab. So it is meant not only for detecting one disease. There are different categories, level 1, level 2, level 3, level 4. So depending on the microorganisms or the pathogens which can be detected or tested in that particular lab, this grading is given, level 1, level 2, level 3, level 4. So it is this level 3 doesn't mean that it is meant only for diagnosing COVID or something like that. So the more pathogenic or severe or dangerous the organism is, we cannot test it in any other lab. It has to be tested in a lab which has some criteria like level 2, level 3, level 4. So level 4 means most dangerous organisms can be tested. Level 3 means like less severe. So those levels are given there. Not having a BSL 3 or 4 doesn't mean that you cannot do the COVID testing. And to establish a BSL 3 or 4, it's not an easy thing. Because we have to follow certain specifications. Some standards are there, criteria are there, which must be followed to build that one. So with RT-PCR, the bigger machine, we need such kind of safety measures. But good thing about TrueNet is like, when we are collecting samples for testing, there is a vial where we collect the sample. And after that, it is transported to the laboratory. From there, the laboratory will do the testing. So what happens is like in this TrueNet, we have this viral lysis media. Once this medium is put in the lysis media, the virus is killed. So we are not dealing with a live pathogen. We are dealing with a dead virus. So the safety or the precautions which we need to take in a BSL-3, that is not required. Of course, a person who is doing the test is supposed to put on the full PPE and conduct the testing, but like since we are dealing with a virus which has been killed, that safety requirements are not that much essential as long as we have a biosafety cabinet. Cabinet is a small instrument. If you have a biosafety cabinet, that is enough for doing this test. Having a biosafety cabinet is preferable, but even without biosafety cabinet also you can conduct a TrueNet testing. So the good thing about TrueNet is it is small, it is portable, and we don't require such high standards of safety.
So again, in very simple words, what you have said and what I can summarize from your talk at the moment is we are at a very safe level of the laboratory as compared to any other labs doing the COVID-19 tests. Am I correct in that?
Yes, you can say like that. As long as the people who are conducting the test follow all the standard protocols that has been written, and if they wear appropriate PPE for conducting TrueNAT testing, we can say if you are following the correct procedure, if you are careful and wearing PPE, then it's okay. We don't require a BSL 3 or 4.
How many technicians are currently working for the testing done in the TrueNAT?
Right now, we have detailed 2 technicians. But if the workload increases, if the number of samples that needs to be tested increases, we have already discussed with our chief medical officer. So if required, manpower from other sections can be pulled in as per the need.
Now coming to the test report that is given out by the TrueNAT, can we be 100% sure? Or is it so that we need to send it for a retest to some other labs?
That is a very important question, because there are so many misconceptions regarding that. Like mentioned earlier, it is a test which detects the viral RNA. Since it is detecting the viral RNA, it is like confirmatory for the sample. So let me try to explain why it is confirmatory for the sample. So it may be a negative report or a positive report. Positive report, there are some more steps which has to be done. So I will explain later on. But regarding the negative report, if it is negative, it means it is confirmatory negative for the sample. So why we are saying that one is, suppose a person is infected with coronavirus. So we don't know when he's infected. If he is symptomatic, having symptoms of cough, fever, running nose, like that, there is a high probability that we will get a positive report. But suppose somebody who is infected but doesn't have any symptoms, or having very mild symptoms, and we are doing the testing. So there is a term called viral load. In simple language, we can say viral load is the amount of virus that is present in your body. So initially, if you are infected, most probably we got infected by a single virus. But it takes time. It will go inside the body, it will multiply, and it will become more. So initially, the number of virus in your body will be very less. So the chances of getting the virus when you're taking the sample will be taken either from the throat or the nose. We call it nasopharyngeal and throat swab. So if you're not having any symptom, chances of getting a positive virus sample in that sample are less. You may get it, you may not get it. So if the person is not displaying any symptoms initially, and also another factor is like sample taking also, there might be some error in collection of sample if it is not taken from the proper site again. You might have taken the sample from the proper place, but if the virus is not present in your throat because the level was very low, so you will get a negative result. So that's why it is negative for the sample. But later on, if you develop some symptoms after 2-3 days, or if you're having problem, then we can repeat the testing. Then when we repeat the testing, if it is COVID, like we will get the result. So when it first COVID case from Nagaland, that from Dimapur, his first sample was positive, second sample was negative, and the third sample was positive again. So we don't know, but we are not the one who have done the testing. So there could be some problem in the machine, or like sampling was not taken properly. We don't know. Some practical issues are there. So that's why when we do a testing, and like mentioned earlier, if the viral load is very less, then even if you might be infected, chances of getting negative is more than positive. Of course, like right now, most of the positive patients are asymptomatic. So we can get it also, but like we may not get it also. So nothing is foolproof.
We have full faith and hope that whatever that TrueNAT shows us will prove to be really helpful to the at least medical fraternity that is working tirelessly against the COVID-19 pandemic. Now, coming again to this testing issue, we have heard or we have come across or read in the social media that there are fast testing kits which can be just tested at home by oneself. How far is it true?
Please don't believe whatever is available in the social media. Try to go to websites which are government approved. Just don't believe in all the websites or what messages that you get in the WhatsApp and all. So it may be true, it may not be true, but what we are doing here is like we are following the ICMR guidelines. So If any test kit is approved by the ICMR, okay. So we receive letters, and also if they have approved it, we'll go ahead and do the testing using that particular kit or whatever test kit they have provided us. But the most reliable test as of now is detection of viral RNA. But it is a very expensive test. That is why ICMR has laid down certain criteria of who can be tested, who cannot be tested.
Now that you have already spoken about who can get tested according to the guideline of the ICMR, who are the people who can really get tested? Or is it possible for any person who feels that he need to get a test for COVID-19? Is it possible for him to just come walk into the lab and then get tested?
As of now, that is not possible. All right. As of now, because there is a scarcity of test kits, everything. A TrueNet test, like in private lab, they charge around 4,500 rupees per test. But whatever is being provided by the government, we are doing it free, of course, as of now. So we cannot just do testing for everybody. So a person must fulfill certain criteria. They must be symptomatic. They must have come from an area which is infected, or those people who have contact with a laboratory confirmed case, person who has been diagnosed after test that he is already positive, and then those who were near and dear, close to the persons, those people might be tested. But anybody just coming and asking for a test, if he's not having any problem in his body, if he's not symptomatic, he has not gone to a red zone or a contaminated area, he's not coming from a high risk area, then no, we won't be doing the testing. Certain criteria have to be fulfilled. Based on that, we will be doing the testing.
Now, say for example, I've gone to a red zone area or I've gotten close with someone who is positive. I come for a test. My test result comes as negative. So what interval of time should I follow to come for the next test?
ICMR has laid down certain criteria. So what they are saying is like the best time for testing is between 5th day to 10th day. But the problem will be, we have to guess what could be the time when you got infected, because nobody knows when were you really infected. We don't know. So that is why they are, one of the criteria is like person should be symptomatic, having problems and all, usually. If you can guess the exact time when you got infected, then between 5th to 10th day is the ideal time when you can do the testing.
Now, doctor, regarding the procedure of tests that you follow here, in this regard, at the beginning, we learned that the samples were being sent to Johar, Dibrugarh. Now there was some issue that when it takes too long, the virus it dies off. But you have just said that whatever sample comes to the lab, you first kill the virus and then you do the test. So how do you justify this?
Before coming to your question, let me tell you, while taking sample and transporting it for testing, we are supposed to follow certain criteria. So if we have collected the sample and the testing can be done within 2 days, then like we can store the sample around 4 to 8 degrees centigrade. If it is supposed to be done after 1 week, then the storage has to be done around -20 degrees centigrade. If the test can be done more than 1 week after you have collected the sample, it has to be stored at a much colder temperature. Those criteria are there. So the person who is, or the center which is transporting the sample, should take every precaution so that the sample does not get damaged on the way, and it should be transported in a maintaining the cold chain system with ice packs and all. And whenever we send a sample for testing, we get back a report from the center which is doing the testing. Along with the report, there will be condition of the sample, whether it is damaged, good or okay. As far as Mokokchung is concerned, all the samples which you have sent, there is no negative report. Okay, and regarding the second part of your question, if it is dead, how are you doing the testing? So the virus itself, you cannot exactly say whether it is a living thing also or not, because this is an RNA virus. It contains an RNA strand only. It doesn't contain even a DNA. So why it is infecting people is because this virus, it requires a host to multiply and propagate. So that is why it is entering inside the human cells, then it is getting multiplied. the symptoms, the disease which you're seeing, it is a side effect of those multiplication only. Virus getting inside your host cell, multiplying and damaging the host cell. So, as mentioned, we are detecting the RNA. So, if the viral RNA is present in the sample, it is first treated with some solutions. We have some technical terms like primer. So, we are not taking the whole virus and doing the testing. We just require the RNA. So if the RNA is present, the RNA will be extracted. After that, it will be added with certain chemicals which will help in amplification of the RNA. So we are not testing the whole virus. We just require the viral RNA. Even in that RT-PCR, larger RT-PCR machines, what they are doing is, after certain step, they also kill off the virus. After that, they extract the RNA. The procedure is same. Doesn't make much difference. So it's not that the live virus is being tested, nothing of that sort. We just require the RNA.
Thank you for clarifying that doubt as well. Coming back to our facility here in Mawokchung, how many machines do you have and what is the rate of tests that you do on a daily basis?
Right now we just have one TrueNet machine, and which is also a single channel. Single channel means we can just do one test at a time. So each test will take approximately around 1 hour to be finished. That's why we can do a less number of tests in a day. But I have heard that these legislatures also, district task force also, are about to provide some more TrueNet machines. So if it is available, then we can do the testing at a much faster pace.
So practically in a day, how many tests do you do?
As I mentioned earlier, one test takes around approximately 1 hour. And since the machine which we have is a single channel one, we can do just one test at a time. So if we work continuously non-stop, maybe we can do around 20 tests in a day.
And comparatively with the BSL 3 to 4 labs, is it easy enough or is it quick enough to set up a TrueNet test machine here in our facility itself?
Looking at the healthcare setup, not only here in Mawokchung, but all over our state.
Okay.
This is just my personal opinion. Having a TrueNet machine will be much better, looking at the manpower status and also the setup of our healthcare facilities. Because to run a BSL 2, 3, 4 lab, it's not an easy thing. If we don't follow these protocols properly, then instead of testing those various diseases, those centers might be again be a source of infection. So it is better to have a TrueNet machine. And I would like to mention that the test kit which we have right now is just a screening test. But the company has already developed another cartridge for this TrueNet machine, which will detect the RT-RB gene of that virus. So once the cartridge becomes available, then we will be able to conduct confirmatory testing also. We don't have to send a sample outside for testing. First initial screening, if a sample is positive, we will do the testing in the RT-RB cartridge. And if it is positive, it is confirmatory and it has been approved by ICMR.
Okay.
So then we don't have to send a sample outside.
So in relation to that, how many tests have we done so far here in our Mawokchung TrueNet?
Through TrueNet, we have done around 41 tests as of now. And we have collected more number of samples, but it has been sent to Dibrugarh and Kohima for RT-PCR.
And all of them have been negative?
So far, yeah.
Okay. Even our quarantine facilities in Mawokchung, we have people coming from different parts of the country. So what about their tests?
We are doing both. So some of the samples, we are doing the testing here. Some of the samples we are sending outside.
Thank you for the information. In a lot of discussion with different doctors and people from our medical fraternity, it has clearly been mentioned that so long the immune system stays strong, then the person does not show the sign, and rather we term it as asymptomatic. So, as a pathologist, how far do you justify that statement? Can we really expect that we Nagas having a little stronger immune system than the rest of the people with whomever we may compare, that is, does it really work in that way that the virus will not show up more easily in we people?
If you're asking about us Nagas being differently immune, then I won't agree. Because everybody, like the basic genetic material of all people, almost same. Some variations will be there, but it depends on the personally. So we cannot say that we Nagas are immune and these people from other places are not immune, nothing of that sort. Everyone is susceptible. It only depends on the immune system of the individual. So maybe you are asking the question based on why most of the tested positive are asymptomatic in Nagaland as of now. I might be wrong, but one of my reasoning is most of those returnees are young people. So young people, usually they have a very good immune system compared to the elderly people. So if it is occurring in the young people, majority will be like they can just recover from that infection. But if the infection happens in an elderly person, then their immune system, and usually they will be having other comorbid conditions, other diseases like diabetes, hypertension. So along with those things, if they are infected, then chances of them having a more severe infection will be more compared to young people. It doesn't mean that young people won't get infected. It's nothing of that sort. But because of when you're young, usually you have a very healthy immune system. But in elderly, it won't be like that. So if an elderly person gets infected, chances of that person having severe signs and symptoms are more.
Doctor, one more thing. As a doctor, as a person who really knows the RNA of the coronavirus, in your very personal view, that is, can we expect that a person's immune system will itself fight against the coronavirus and keep him away from the COVID-19 without any medicine, that is?
See, as of now, there is no treatment available. So if somebody gets infected with the virus and gets admitted in the hospital, what we are going to do is like we'll be giving symptomatic treatment only. If he's having fever, we will be giving medicines for fever. If he's having difficulty in breathing, maybe we will give oxygen inhalation like that. So we are just fully dependent on the immune system of the person who's been infected to clear the virus from its body. Maybe after some days, maybe we will get some medicines which will kill the virus. But as of now, almost all the treatment is based on the body's immune system to clear off that virus. That is why we have this asymptomatic people also. Somebody who is infected but doesn't have any symptoms in his body. So why is it? Because his immune system is good enough to contain the virus. I'm not asking people to be careless so that if they get infected, okay, just roam here and there without proper precautions. No, nothing of that sort. But we have to be careful. We have to take every precautions. As they say, prevention is better than cure. But at the same time, we should not be so scared that if I get infected with coronavirus that, okay, I'm going to die or something like that. It's nothing of that sort. Out of 100 people, almost 80% will have mild, moderate symptoms only, and they will just recover. And how that is happening? That is happening through the immune system of the person. That's it. And remaining maybe 10-15 will have some more moderate type of symptoms. Only around 5% will have some severe symptoms like that. So we are depending on the body's immune system to fight the virus.
So after all this thorough discussion, I also on behalf of the radio station, to all the listeners, would like to request to boost your immune system. Of course, we have discussed on our past episodes on how to manage your immune system as well. So you can always refer to our YouTube channel, which is AIR Mukukchung. Well, Doctor, thank you so much for your time. And I hope our discussion here will give a ray of hope as well as ease the mind of a lot of people who are in big confusion about the test that has been carried out here in Mukukchung or else in other parts of our state. So thank you so much, Doctor, for your time.
Thank you for having me.